We're in the middle of a billion-dollar telescope building boom. The giant Magellan telescope, 30-meter telescope, and Europe's extremely large telescope are all part of a new class of ground-based observatories that will peer farther through space and further back in time.
Astronomers are not very good with names. First, we built big telescopes, and then we made the very large telescope, and now we're making extremely large telescopes. But really what it means, it's about 10 times larger than any telescope we have today.
They're all racing to see first light in the 2020s. But why now? How did we get here?
Typically, the size of the largest telescope on the Earth doubles about every 40 years. Around 2000, there were groups around the globe who had just finished building telescopes that are about 8 and 10 meters in diameter. And they recognized that technology could be used to make telescopes even larger. And that was about the time also that we discovered that, as astronomers, we have no idea what's actually going on in the universe. I mean no idea, in the sense that we figured out that 97% of the stuff in the universe can't be seen, and we don't know what it is. So that was a good motivation to build bigger telescopes.
The technology got better for us to make this quantum jump from, 8-meter to 30-meter class. And this comes down to, few key elements.
The first is a revolution in mirror size and design.
The telescope performance are mostly driven by the size of the primary mirror. The bigger the primary mirror, the more light you can collect. That means you can go fainter into the universe. You can look at smaller objects or more distant objects.
But the problem is you can't make one single mirror any larger than about 20 feet in diameter. There's just basic material properties in the glass that make it very difficult to make. So we have to make mirror segments. We take the parent optical surface, and kind of like with a biscuit cutter, we cut it into 7 circles. We make them to one combined parent optical surface that brings the light then to a single focus. We have to then hold those mirrors in place on a large steel structure that's stiff enough that it doesn't shake in the wind and it doesn't sag under its own weight. And then it has to be precise enough to steer across the sky so that when we move to track the stars or the planets, there's no vibration. And we do that, strangely enough, by floating the entire telescope, entire 1,000 tons, on a thin film of oil. And the telescope simply floats on that in a way that's completely frictionless.
That's the design for the giant Magellan telescope, whereas the EELT will take a slightly different approach.
The original idea was to build not a 40-meter diameter, but 100-meter diameter. And that was called the overwhelmingly large telescope. That was so big that the engineer said, this is really too much for us. The shape of the telescope has to be precise to a few tens of nanometers. So the width of a hair across the entire 40-meter diameter of the primary, which is actually not even one single piece, is made of 798 individual smaller mirrors. Each of them needs to be polished, extremely accurate, and then controlled to mimic this uniform surface at the nanometer level.
These enormous precision machines will be built in some of the driest and most remote places on Earth, rivaling the power of space telescopes like Hubble and the soon-to-launch James Webb.
So Hubble Space has been fantastic, pioneering work, but they are somehow, they've been pushed to their limit. So what I'm expecting is these 30-meter telescopes to do exactly the same revolution as Hubble did 20 years ago.
But one major challenge these ground-based scopes have to contend with is our planet's atmosphere.
The problem is the light from the stars that's traveled for millions of years, or sometimes billions of years through the universe and through the galaxy, when it hits our atmosphere, the light kind of wiggles as it goes through.
This is what gives the stars their classic twinkle, but it causes problems for astronomers who want super sharp images. This is where the next key advance comes in.
Recently, over the last 10 years, there's been a lot of development in what is called adaptive optics.
Here's how it works. Lasers from the telescope are shot into space, exciting the atoms in the sodium layer of the upper atmosphere and causing them to glow. That glow acts as an artificial star that astronomers can use to calculate the amount of atmospheric turbulence. Then, the mirrors will flex and deform by computer-controlled actuators to correct the blur.
And voila, you make sharp images. The challenge is you have to do that 500 to 1,000 times a second, and you have to do that to about 1/20th of the wavelength of light in precision.
With unprecedented light collecting capability and advanced optical geometry, these new observatories will tackle some of the most complex questions known to science.
There's been a lot of recent discovery of exoplanets. We can see more or less how distant they are from the planet, but we would like to understand how they're made of. Do they have an atmosphere which is similar to Earth or not? How do you form all these planets? That's only one aspect. Then understanding how different galaxies form and evolve across the cosmic time, now for 13.5 billion years. And then we can move to cosmology, understanding how dark matter, dark energy formed. We are increasing the size so much, the capabilities are so powerful that they will open completely new discovery space. And we don't know where they will take us. And that's, for me, is the real beauty of these new facilities.
Our telescopes, while they might seem big, they're really small compared to the size of the Earth or the size of the universe. So if we can collect more light, we have a better chance of seeing those galaxies and black holes back when the universe was less than 1 billion years old. And that's one of our key drivers, is to look back and see, when did we transition from the universe being dark, the end of the Dark Ages, to the first time it lit up, what we call cosmic dawn. That's something that all astronomers would like to see and study, you know, the first light in the universe. The universe is a much bigger place than just what we experience here in our daily lives on the Earth. That it's rich, it's full of completely unexpected and diverse phenomena, and that it's something that just, it's bigger than any of us.
For more science documentaries, check out this one right here. Don't forget to subscribe and keep coming back to Seeker for more videos.